Okay, welcome guys. Welcome back. Happy New Year. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your presence here tonight, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that you have a way in this meeting, Father God. And we just want to lift up these requests that you brought before us, Lord, and you put on the hearts of our brothers, Lord. For my brother Russ, who's not here tonight, who wants prayer for Steve. Steve is in the hospital with numerous things going on, and Nicole has COVID. And that's Russ's daughter-in-law, Father, and there's been some contact, Father. So we just pray for the family, Lord, for the healing for both Steve and Nicole. And we just pray that you'd just protect the rest of the family from any sickness, Father God. We just pray that you'd be glorified, Lord, in the lives and the healing of these people, Lord. And for our brother Daniel, Lord, he asked us to pray for the unborn, Father, and a revival in our hearts and a revival for our nation, Father God. And we certainly need that, Lord. The unborn are just cast aside, and our hearts have just been stray, Father, from you, Lord, as a nation, Father. And we just pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would just have a new movement, Father God, in this country and in this world, Father God, and that make a heart sensitive to those who have no voice, such as the unborn, Father God. We just pray, Lord, that we would just once again turn to you as a nation, Father, and repent of our wicked ways, Father God, and just ask for healing for our land, Lord. And Brother Daniel also has the flu, Father, and we just pray for healing for him, Father. Just touch him right now, Father. Just make him strong, Father. Help him to be able to return back to work, Lord, and just bless him and provide for him. Brother Todd has requested we pray for a PSA spike, and there's an MRI on Tuesday, Father. So we just pray for the results of this, Lord. We just pray for healing. We just pray as a miraculous touch on his body, Father God, that there'd be nothing there when they look at the MRI, Father God. So I just pray for peace and comfort for Todd and his family, Lord, as they go through this together, Lord. Our brother Ed, his daughter's friend, and Leslie, she's been cutting on herself, Father, and we know that's not of you, Father. So we just pray for whatever's going through her, Father God, that she would just look to you, Father, for mental strength, Lord, and just healing in her heart, Father God, and just help her to not abuse her body in that way, Lord. We just pray for healing for her and her mind and her body, Lord, and we also want to lift up the pain of shingles that Brother Ed is going through, Father. I just pray for complete healing for that, Lord, that you just stop that from recurring, Father. We also want to pray for our active duty servicemen, our first responders and vets and all their families, Father. I just thank you, Lord, that Brother Ed is quick to remind us each week to pray for these people, Lord, who lay themselves on the line for the rest of us, Lord. And so we just pray, Lord, that you'll be with these people, Lord, that you would strengthen them, Father, and Lord, that they would draw on your strength, Lord, as they protect us as a country, Father. And we want to pray for our leadership in this country, Father, for competence, Father, that you would put men and women in position, Father, this year, Lord, that would make a difference and make a change, Father, that would help lead us, our nation, back to you, Lord, just bring our nation back in control and just not give in to the ways that we've fallen over the last few years, Father God. Every man seeking his own will and his own way, Father. I want to pray for Brother Alan Pepper in our church, one of our ushers, and he's sick and in need of recovery, Father God. We just pray you bless him, Lord, and heal him, Lord. Just help him to get back to work quickly, Father. Father, we want to lift up the foster children in this nation, Father. We pray you just protect them, Father. Lord, you pray that you would find homes for those who are not yet placed, Lord, and that Christian families would open up their homes and their hearts, Father, to take these boys and girls in, Father God, and to just provide a home of love for them, Father. And we just pray in general for the nation's youth, Father, that they would not just follow the ways of the world, Father, and pop culture that just draws them in and into paths that lead away from you, Father God. We just pray that they would, their hearts would turn towards you, Father God, that they'd be drawn into youth outreaches and ministries, Father, and that they would come to know you, Lord. And for our brother Nick, I request a prayer for his father Angelo, Lord. Just he's in pain, Father, not sleeping at night. And we just pray for that he would have a good night's sleep tonight, Lord, even that you would just touch him and just take away that back pain, Father, and help him to rest and wake up rested and refreshed, Father God. And our brother Tom, just wanted us to lift up Friday night evangelism at the pier, Father, and you've been using Eric and several others from Refuge, Father God, to faithfully show up every Friday night there, Lord, and just reach out to people, Father, and to stir up a conversation and make them think about eternity and things that they haven't been thinking about on their own, Father God. So I just pray for those who go out there, and even those who are not from Refuge, Father, who just diligently make contact, Lord, with the public and try to share the love of Christ with them, Father. I just pray that you just empower them, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, Father, and that your Spirit would just touch those that are needing to hear about you, Father, and that the hearts would be prepared, Father God. So we pray you'd use this ministry in a special way, Lord, and you would bring more people to even join in with them on Friday nights, Father God. So, Lord, again, we thank you for your presence here tonight, and we just pray you are blessed by the worship, Father, and by the message tonight. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Good evening, guys. Happy New Year. All right. Hey, guys, tonight we're going to be looking at Ephesians chapter 3. So if you can get out your Bibles, your phones, your apps, whatever it is that you use. We're going to be looking at the first 13 verses of Ephesians chapter 3. We've been traveling through Paul's instruction and this doctrine to the church that both Marty and Paul has been talking about. This is a church that Paul's spent the better part of 3 years with. So these guys are pretty doctrinally like taught. They're pretty savvy with it. They understand it. You remember some of the leaders in there, Apollos and Priscilla and Aquila. These were some of the early church leaders in Ephesus. It was amongst, if not one of the largest churches that we know that Paul ministered to in the area. And so in this epistle so far, Paul's kind of reminded them of these tremendous gifts, these riches in Christ. Marty outlined a whole bunch of them. Paul kind of worked on some last time in chapter 2. And so tonight, we're going to look at a kind of another little spiritual blessing, but it's in the way of a mystery. You guys like a mystery, don't you? Well, it's not that kind of mystery. It's not a Scooby-Doo, and it's not like a Perry Mason or anything like that. But we're going to dive into this mystery tonight, but first we're going to pray. So, Lord, we just come before you this evening, just really grateful for this opportunity to be able to dive into your word, to let it speak to us, to have your Holy Spirit penetrate our hearts over it and change us, God, and have us to do what it is that you want us to do. So I just pray for a blessing on your word tonight, an anointing of it, and that you would open the eyes and ears of our hearts and our minds to receive tonight. And we pray this in Jesus' name. So Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1 says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus for you Gentiles." So Paul is describing himself. He's currently a prisoner, and he's writing this epistle from a Roman prison. So that's where Paul's located, but there's a reason. There's a cause, he says, for this reason. There's a cause that he's there. And he says it's for the Gentiles. It's for you Gentiles. He's not exactly blaming it on them, but he kind of is. It's like that's why Paul was there. Paul was in prison because of this missionary efforts that he's been going through, speaking and using the calling that God gave to him to reach out and share the gospel with the Gentiles. And that's getting Paul into some trouble. But the Gentiles could believe in Christ, and that would be accounted to them for righteousness. So in chapter 1, we were talking about it's by faith and all those kinds of things. This is available to to them, just as it was for Abraham. It was accounted to Abraham as righteousness for his faith. And so this message that Paul has, there was no difference between Jew and Gentile. They both could come to faith in Christ, and that's the thing that Paul was getting in a lot of trouble with. To the leaders that kept following him, this was a blasphemous message. In fact, everywhere Paul went in preaching this gospel to the Gentiles, he seemed to get in trouble. He was beaten. He was stoned, if you remember. He was thrown into jail in many places. If you think about the locations that he's been in Antioch and in Iconium and Philippi and Lystra, and these Jewish leaders were following Paul kind of behind him from Antioch and Iconium, and they were stirring up trouble. So Paul would be talking to, you know, somebody at Philippi and in the synagogues there and in Lystra, and these guys would come in and they would stir up this trouble, and they were persuading the multitudes to go after Paul. So, and if you remember in Jerusalem, in the book of Acts, that's where Paul was there, and he stirred up the people, or the people stirred up against Paul. And when Paul was permitted to speak to them, if you remember, he was kind of rescued and he was kind of heading up the stairs with the Roman guards. And he said, hey, let me talk to these guys. And so the Roman guard permitted him to do so. And Paul went on to give him like his personal testimony. And they were all listening. They were listening to every word that Paul was an ex, you know, Pharisee. And he did all of this stuff, persecuting the church and going after the church. Right up to the part where Paul said that he was going to be speaking to the Gentiles, that's where Jesus had told him, hey, depart, for I'm going to send you far away from here to the Gentiles. And that's the part when they stopped listening. And they went crazy and they cried out, away with such a fellow. He's not even permitted to be on the earth. So they plotted to kill him. And they accused him of sedition. If you remember, Paul finally appeals to Caesar. And so they got him out of there. And he was over at Caesarea for a while. So Paul was this prisoner. But notice how Paul sees it. He sees it a little differently. He's not a prisoner of Rome. Look at that verse again. And he says, I'm a prisoner of Christ. That's how he sees himself. Yeah, he was in a Roman prison. Yes, he was going through it. But he saw himself as this prisoner of Christ. He was captured by Christ. And he was given this call, a mission, this cause that we're talking about. Paul was compelled to preach the gospel. And whatever happens, happens. God's in control. That was his attitude. And he was there because God let him be there. He was in jail because that's where God had him to be. But God used Paul in a very mighty way in the circumstances that he was under. So maybe it wasn't fun for Paul, but Paul saw it as a God thing. Think about the things that happened while Paul was in prison. Can you guys think of one of the things that Paul did while he was in prison? There's a couple of things that he did. He brought Roman guards to the Lord. That's one of them. We're going to talk about that in a second with a passage. Well, he also wrote four epistles from this Roman prison. So the epistle of Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. So he wrote from many different prisons, but this is where he was at in prison. He had kind of like a prison ministry, and that's called the prison epistles. So guards were getting saved. Paul was chained to them like all the time. And so he had a chance to share with them and be able to spread this gospel message to them that, hey, this is for you too. And so they were getting saved. And as he wrote to the Philippians, he said, greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The brethren who are with me greet you. All the saints greet you. But he says, especially those who are of Caesar's household. See, people in Caesar's household were getting saved. So God was using Paul in this great way. And you know what, guys? Whether you like it or not, God's going to use our trials and our circumstances for his glory in the same kind of a way. Whether that's in your financial situation, could be a job situation that's going bad. It could be a relationship with your family, your kids. Some way or another, you know, you go through it. Even your health situation. And with his permission, I want to demonstrate this with an example of one of our own from Bob and Rocky Anderson right here. As many of you know, Bob's taking care of his wife, Rocky. And again, I talked to Bob and got his permission to share this. And so with the chronic health that they're dealing with and the on and off again on meds and just the hospice care being on, off, God's working so mightily through them. And I can't tell you what a blessing it is to watch a couple who, by all accounts, like Paul, have many reasons to complain, many reasons to kind of be down and out. But you know what? Every time I see them, they're praising the Lord. They're showing up. They're demonstrating God's strength and God's grace and his mercy through the very situation that they're in. And it's a miraculous thing. This is a God thing that's happening. So watching them go through this difficulty blesses others. It's a witness. It's a testimony to others that watch them go through these tough times. And they're still showing up and they're still praising God. So in speaking with Bob, though, about this, he said the biggest thing that it really spoke to them about as they are going through this was how it impacted other people. And he said that was the greatest thing that they've experienced so far, was how their situation has impacted other people. And he said for all of that, it's worth it. That's what he told me. I don't know how he could do that or how he could say that, but to say that it was worth it, that's what he said. And I think that that's pretty awesome. And this is how Paul, while sitting in this Roman prison, is saying, I'm a prisoner of Christ for you Gentiles. And Paul's being used. It's his cause. It's that same reason. So we're also going to see in verse 2 this dispensation that's been given to him, this dispensation of grace. So verse 2 says, if indeed you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which was given to me for you. So don't get tripped up on this word dispensation. As a rule, it means a general state or ordering of things. And in our case, it's like this method or scheme according to which God carries out his purposes towards men. That's called a dispensation. It's like a special message that was given to Paul to give out, revealing it to people. It's like an age. You've heard of the age of Aquarius. People use that terminology. Well, this is the age of grace. This is the dispensation of grace. It's the age of relating to God in a different way. Before it was the law, they related to him, and now he's revealed that it's going to be through grace. And over the Bible, if you read it from beginning to end, you'll see these different revealings of how God's plan is really unfolding in different times and in different ways that he's doing that. Some people see there's three different dispensations back in the patriarchal days. Then you have the Mosaic or the Jewish dispensation, and then now the Christian dispensation. Others see much more than that, so you can look up different commentaries. John Corson has one where he sees basic 8 ones, but they all warn you of getting a little too carried away about breaking it down into, it's a tool. That's what they all said. It's a tool for you to kind of give a guide as to where, how, and what God's revealing to believers and people on how God's relating to them. So in Paul's case, he's been given this dispensation of grace. So like I said, before it was, they were relating to God through the law, the priests were the intermediaries, they were making sacrifices, but now it's through grace. So we're saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. So that's how we are now, even today, we're relating with God through this grace. So next we jump into the actual mystery, starting in verse 3. This is kind of how it came about. He says, how that by revelation, he, that's God, made known to me the mystery, as I have written briefly already, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit of his holy apostles and prophets, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel, of which I, Paul, became a minister according to the grace, that gift of grace of God given to me by the effective working of his power. So here, this mystery is defined in our verse. In verse 5, it's in other ages it was not known, but now it's been revealed to man. So Paul alluded to this in chapter 2, if you guys remember, when Paul went through it, our coach Paul went through it. So what's this mystery? You know, it's that the Gentiles would be fellow heirs, that they would be of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel. So the mystery wasn't that the Gentiles were going to get saved, because there's lots of scriptures. I'll just blow out four of them for you. Genesis 12:3, he said to Abraham, all the families of the earth shall be blessed through you. And in Isaiah 49:6, he said, I will also give you to Christ as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. That's in Isaiah. And Zechariah 2:11 says, many nations shall be joined to the Lord in that day, and they shall become my people. And one more in Malachi chapter 1, verse 11 says, from the rising of the sun even to its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. In every place incense shall be offered to my name, and a pure offering, for my name shall be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts. So again, this mystery is not that the Gentiles were going to get saved, because that was well known throughout Scripture that God was going to bring this light to them. So the mystery that God was unfolding here was that both the Jew and the Gentile would come together. They would do so in the same body, in the same way. They would come to Christ exactly the same way, and they would have the same benefits, and they would have the same promises. Now, you remember in some of the other epistles that the Jewish believers, sometimes they had a little hard time with this, because they struggled with this, and they argued that, no, you got to first become a Jew and be circumcised and follow the law, then you can be saved. And that was corrected through Peter and Paul along the way. But that's not what Paul's teaching here. Both Jews and Gentiles come to this faith in Christ as they are. It's no longer an us and them type of situation. They're one in Christ. Both inherit the kingdom. They both inherit the promises of God. They make up the same body of believers, all working together, functioning as the body of Christ. Some, as you remember, Paul wrote, some are teachers, some are prophets, some are evangelists. Some have the gift of helps, gift of healings, on and on and on. So those are the things all working together, functioning as one. And we see this working today. We don't look at things the same way now because we don't even think that this is any different, because we see it already as one. We see the body of Christ. We have pastors, teachers, children's ministry, food ministry, and on and on and on, paraministries. These are all people working together as the body of Christ. We saw that. We don't have any issues with that. But back then, they did. They had trouble with this. So it wasn't revealed before, but now Paul's revealing this mystery so that we all are on the same page that it's one. So it's important to also see that Paul wasn't the only one this was revealed to. So Paul's not making this up like for himself. You know, in there in verse 5, it tells us also that it was revealed to his holy apostles and prophets. Why is that important? It's important because, you know, they could accuse Paul of just making this up, like, you know, how do we know? But they gave it to somebody else. If you remember, it was revealed to Peter when he went on to have that dream in Acts chapter 10, where the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And what God revealed to him was that the things that they would call unclean are not what God calls unclean. And he said, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And he's like, not so. And he said, don't do it. And this is what it says. Peter had perceived that God shows no partiality. And so when he came to Cornelius and was preaching to the family, it says in Acts chapter 10, verse 44, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision, that's the Jews, who believed were astonished. That's because they weren't looking for that. That's because they didn't know that that's what it was. That's why this mystery is now being revealed. And those of that household were astonished because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. So we can see that this was something new. So next we notice in verse 7, Paul was given a gift to perform his calling as a minister. as a servant. So today we'd call, in the church, it'd be a deacon. Out in the world, we'd call it a waiter. So at a restaurant, somebody that waits tables on that. But that's what Paul's calling himself. He's like a deacon for Christ and a waiter for the rest of the world. So how's Paul able to do all of this? So the answer for Paul and for all of us was found in verse 7. And this is what this gift is. It's given to Paul by the grace of God. He says it's by the effective working of his power. That's God's power that's on Paul. We've prayed tonight, and I'm sure you guys all pray. We can't do the things that we do on our own. You guys know that, right? We can't do that on our own. So whenever God's calling you or I to do anything for the Lord, we need, as his body, we need his power. We need to have his power in order to function in the role, in order to do the things that God's call. It's a must. We can't do it without it. And he says it's by the effecting of his power. That's that dunamis power. That's the power that raised Christ from the dead. It's the same thing that's in you and me. And that's, we're asking often enough, hopefully, for his anointing on us. So that's God's power working in our lives. So as Zechariah said, it's not by might nor by power, but my spirit, says the Lord. So men, we can't be or even do what God's calling us to do without it. So all of what Paul's doing, he's just saying, you know, the ability, anything that he still has this ability to praise God in his difficult circumstances. He's writing epistles. He's preaching the gospel. But it's by the effective working of God's power in him, and that God wants to work in your life in the same way. So next we're going to see in verses 8 through 12, this fellowship of this mystery. So now he's given us the mystery. Now we're going to look at the fellowship of mystery. So verse 8 says, to me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Christ Jesus, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God may be known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access and confidence through faith in him. So first, when Paul says the unsearchable riches, what he means is not, it's like you can't find it. What he means is it's kind of like in the sense of it's past finding out in its fullness. You can't fully comprehend it. You're so amazed that you can't even fathom what's going on. And in 2 Corinthians, Paul wrote, and I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know, God knows. He was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which is not lawful for man to utter. In Romans 11, he talks about the depths of the riches, both the wisdom and knowledge of God. And he says how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. In Job, we read, who does great things and unsearchable, miraculous things without number? Speaking of God, Job 9 says he does great things past finding out. So, you know, all over we discover what it really truly means that it's unsearchable. It's not that it's not there. It's just we can't put our heads around it. So when you look up at the sky at night and you just look at the vastness of the space, you can't grasp the wisdom that it took for God to put that out there. And he just flung it out there like it was nothing. And you look under a microscope at the DNA and even at the subatomic levels, we can't understand, and we're in awe of this wisdom of how God might have created things so vital. These small things are very highly vital, but yet we can't even see it with our eyes. That's a miraculous thing. So what I kind of come to the conclusion is like, what more is there that I don't know? You know, what else is out there? And Paul just says it's unsearchable. It's past finding out. And God, he just has so much more for you than you even realize. So the second thing in verse 9, he talks about this fellowship of the mystery. Paul was saying was hidden God. God, for whatever reason, chose to hide it before, and now in his wisdom, he's revealing it. So what is this fellowship of the mystery? And we see that previously the Jews and the Gentiles didn't get along, did they? They kind of hated each other. And in doing so, they had the separation. So they had a really hard time when they were told that they were all going to be a part of the same body for them to kind of get over it as far as being able to be of unity in one body. In more than one place, he talks about having unity in the body of Christ. So chapter 2, verse 9 says that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death this enmity. So this enmity he's talking about is this division between them, this hostility that they had towards one another. And now they're being told that God's going to treat them equally and they need to treat each other equally as well. They're one in the body of Christ. So now notice that Paul says in verse 9 that he wants to make all see this fellowship of the mystery. He wants them to see the how and the why. So how can Paul make them see this? Firstly, Paul wants them to see it in him. And in and through his life, Paul is really going through it, beaten, jailed, all the things we just talked about from the world's perspective, really wanting for the comfort that we would all enjoy. But Paul, he wants them to see it himself. He sees himself as a prisoner of Christ. He's focused on the gospel, preaching in the face of this persecution. Can you imagine if Paul decided, you know what? I'm tired of this. I'm done. All he had to do was stop preaching the gospel. All he had to do was stop telling people that you could come to faith in Christ and that Jews and Gentiles could come the same way. That's all he had to do, and it would have been over. He wouldn't have had the same kind of persecution. But yet, he's praising the Lord in this tribulation. He's ministering to the saints everywhere. These letters were given, and they were like given out to multiple churches for everybody to read. And he was being used by God to bless other people. So it's Paul's desire that they see it in him first and in his circumstances, that God's grace is working through him and that the strength that he has is not his own. It's God's strength, and it can only be had by God. The second reason that is given is that the church would now demonstrate this mystery to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. That's what it says in verse 10. So why did God do this? What was his intent in doing that? It says there in verse 10 that God wanted to use the church to display his wisdom to the angels in the heavenly places. Why? The angels are all over the place. They're watching the whole time, right? But in fact, they don't know everything that there is. But the thing that God's trying to show them is his wisdom in bringing the Jews and Gentiles together as one. This mystery is being revealed to them. We know that the angelic beings in Mark 13, it says, but of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven. So they don't know everything that's going on. And God's using the church to display how this is working, how his wisdom is coming about, how it's being revealed to man. It's being revealed to them as well. And he's using the church to do that. And in 1 Peter, you remember that it just says that the things that the angels were desirous to look into. So God's teaching and showing the angelic beings about his wisdom and using the church to do it. The third thing that God showed that it was his eternal purpose in that verse, it was accomplished in Christ, that all would see that this wisdom was accomplished in Christ at the cross. So verse 12 tells us also that this was all done according to God's eternal purpose. Combining the believing Jews and the Gentiles into one body, that was all accomplished, you realize, at the death of Christ on the cross. So when Christ died, he said, it is finished. And he doesn't talk just about it's finished, the work was done and all of that, but it's also finished in that these two parties were brought together. If you remember, the veil was torn. So the Jews now had access to God that they didn't have before. He tells the Romans and the Corinthians in various epistles that they were now reconciled to God together. When Christ died on the cross, he made this way for the both of them to be that, all according to God's eternal purpose. And that was all accomplished in Christ. So in doing so, this mystery now grants both of them the same. And he says it in there. They have boldness in their faith. They have access to God. And they could do so with confidence, he says. So that's what Paul's teaching them, and Paul's teaching us, that we all have this same thing through our faith in Christ. They didn't have this boldness before. If you remember, The history of the Jews as they related to God, they were scared of God. They told Moses, you go up the hill. We don't want to have anything to do with it. Just come back and tell us what he wants. So they had this fear of God, but in a way that they didn't want to relate to God. So they did all of that through the sacrificial system and going to the priests. And they also didn't have access to it. Again, the Jews had nothing. Gentiles didn't even get there because they had to convert if they wanted to have access to God, to Judaism. And they also didn't have the confidence in where they stood. So they didn't have this relationship that we're talking about. You know, they constantly questioning, am I good enough? Did I give enough? Is God going to receive me? So that's why they were so like, I got to follow the law to the umpteenth degree, because they didn't want to mess up in anything at all. And it was a works-based deal. But in Christ, we have all of these things. In Hebrews 4, it says, let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Romans 5:2 says, through whom we also have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And in 1 John 2:28, it says, and now little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. They didn't have this before. This is what was so amazing about this dispensation of grace that Paul was revealing to them, that they could come boldly and have access and have this confidence. They didn't know this. We kind of take it for granted because we grew up in the church and we've read our Bibles and, you know, yeah, I know I can come boldly to God. I know I have access. I don't have to go through Mary or the saints or anybody else. I can just go right in. We call him Abba Father for the same reason, because we have that access. We have that ability and we have confidence in God and his promise, not in anything other than his faithfulness. We have confidence in his faithfulness. So think about this when you're in crisis. When you go to God, he immediately hears you. He says, cast your cares upon me, for I care for you, 1 Peter. So whether your life is in total crisis or things are awesome, we can have this relationship with him where we can come to him, have that same gift of confidence and boldness. The last thing that Paul says in our text tonight in verse 13 is, don't lose heart for me. Paul's a servant. He's this waiter. And he's bound to Christ. And that's how we are. But he says in verse 13, therefore I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory, he says. So Paul's doing this for them. And there's all of the tribulations that he's going through, imprisonment, all that kind of stuff we talked about. Paul understood that this cause, this reason is going to lead to this other stuff. And he rejoiced in it. We saw that. But he says it's for your glory. It's for your benefit. And if Paul wasn't that faithful steward that we talked about, we would not have the same grace given. We wouldn't have this unity in the body of Christ, both Jew and Gentile. We wouldn't have that. And that would be a shame. But praise God that Paul, through God's strength, came out and just stood firm in what he taught. So he's just said it was for your glory and it was on your behalf. So don't worry about me, Paul's saying. This cause is great. The reason's huge. The Gentiles and Jews, you're the reason. That's what he says. It's the gospel message. It's the good news for everybody. Think about it. If you thought for a minute, like, no, I've got to do something else in order to get into a place where God would receive me, you've missed it, because that's not what it's all about. I really, really like what Bob had said about it being worth it. All the pain, all the heartache, all the hassle, to see how it impacts other people, saying that it's worth it. That's exactly what Paul's saying to them. That I'm in the position that I'm in for you, and it's worth it. And that's an amazing thing. So he says, don't worry about me. Amen? Amen. All right, let's pray. So Father, we kind of ran through that quickly, but I just pray that that we would develop that same heart that Paul has about being captured by you, by being called at something. We're all called to something, to serve in the body of Christ. So in doing so, that we would understand that we need you, we need your power, we need your anointing, we need that power working in our lives to change us, to mold us and shape us. God, help us to be able to do that. Thanks for things that we take for granted that they didn't know back then, that we now can be reminded of through your word. And that no circumstances are beyond you, because you use everything. There's nothing that goes to waste. You don't allow something in our lives without a purpose, without a reason. And so we may not ever see it this side of heaven, what that purpose is. We may not hear it from anyone else. We may not even understand or know that it's having impact on other people. But may we see our circumstances in the same way that Paul does, and that it's for your glory and for your purposes. So bless my brothers tonight as they go about, anoint them, help them with their relationships, with their kids, their wives, help them to be beacons of light in and through their workplaces and just all those that they would come into contact with. Lord, may you be honored and glorified in all that we do. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, God bless you guys.
Set free my heart, set free my soul. I don't want to be a prisoner no more. Unlock the door that holds me in. This is the day that life begins.